This is Guardian Radio 96.9 FM, Nassau, Bahamas.
The views and opinions of the hosts and guests are their own and do not necessarily reflect the position of the management and staff of Guardian Networks.
Zee Live Off the Record with Zhivargo Laing is sponsored by Royal Fidelity Bank and Trust, Royal Star Assurance, Fidelity Bank Bahamas, the Water and Sewage Corporation, BTC, the Cleveland Clinic, and the Digital Transformation Unit.
Welcome, ladies and gentlemen, to Zee Live. I'm Zhivargo Laing, your host. So glad you could join us here today on Guardian Radio 96.9 FM on this beautiful Wednesday afternoon. I trust you are doing very well today, as I am. Thank God for small favors and big ones. I want to thank my good friend, an able associate, Hubert Edwards, for filling in so ably for me yesterday. I had a good show. I could only hear parts of it because of what I was engaged in, but I thank him for doing a splendid job as always. Thank you, Hubert. Appreciate you, brother. If you want to give us a call at all today on the show, ladies and gentlemen, you can do so on 323-6232, that's 323-6232, or 325-4316, 325-4316, or 325-4259, that's 325-4259. You can text us at 422-4796, that's 422-4796, or you can WhatsApp me on 439-3043, that's 439-3043. We are, of course, live on Cable Bahamas, channel 969. That's the way my mother listens to the show, or you can catch us on BTC Flow Channel 612. That's BTC Flow Channel 612. So I want to talk economics today. Yeah, I want to talk some economics today. The budget debate is going on. And once again, what is clearly not going to happen is a very sober, very focused, and informative debate on the budget. That's not going to happen in this mid-year budget debate. That's not going to happen. We're going to get fed to what typically we get fed to at budget times during budget debates, which is the politics around small matters, the politics around small matters that look sensational from the perspective of I got your politics. That's going to happen. From some members on both sides are going to do that. And that's what's going to carry the day in the news. That's what's going to carry the day on the corners and on the domino tables at the bar, in between the drinks. We're not going to get a substantial debate on the budget. And what is the budget? The budget is the government's forecast of revenue and the government's plans for spending that revenue. And to the extent that the government is going to incur a deficit, the government's strategy for financing that deficit, period. That's the budget. Let me tell you what it is again. It's the revenue the government forecasts is going to take in. It's not revenue the government has. Can I tell somebody that again? The government will say, we expect to have $2.2 billion in revenue. That is not money in hand, people. Let me say it again for those of you sitting down quietly, noisily listening. There is not a chance on planet Earth that the government of the Bahamas has sitting in a bank account, listen to me carefully, $2 billion, $1 billion, $500 million, $250 million, or $1 on its main account. Chances are it's got an overdraft facility running around $200 plus million overdraft. It may have an account somewhere, one, you know, because it has some earmark accounts and other accounts that have dollars in it. But guess what? If you have a overdraft facility of $200 million and your other accounts are $50 million, your net circumstance is a deficit of $200+ million. So when the government says $2.4 million in revenue or 2.2, it's what it expects to take in. And chances are it will take in the bulk of that. Chances are. But might it take in all of it? It's not sure. It's not guaranteed. And that money is never sitting around on any account for the government to go ahead and just say, yeah, yeah, cash this in. Let's go buy some stuff. Then there's the expenditure. How much are you going to spend in education? How much are you going to spend in Ministry of Finance, Public Works, in immigration, and so forth and so forth and so forth? How much are you going to get the Bahamas there? Water and Sewage Corporation. How much are you going to pay out in capital expenditure for roads and parks and bridges and so forth and so forth? And once you take the revenue, the expenditure from the revenue, if the government spends more than it takes in, it has a deficit and it has to borrow that money. Has to borrow that money. And that's where your deficit comes in, your borrowing comes in, and therefore your national debt comes into play. And that includes its guaranteeing of borrowings from its public corporations like the BPL, Water and Sewage Corporation, Bahamas there, and so forth and so forth. That's the budget. So if you're having a debate, like, why would you have a substantial debate around $2 million accidentally going to some place or erroneously going to some nonprofit that is returned to the government? Why is that a debate now? What is the signal? If it wasn't found to be a criminal act, if it wasn't found to be an unethical arrangement, if all you have is it was an error, why is that taken up any time in a budget debate where your deficit circumstances are substantial and your borrowings accordingly have to follow? On either side, I'm not talking about just the Davis administration, the FNM, the PLP. Why is this a debate? Why does a prime minister, former, have to get all riled up over something like that to make such egregious statements about busing people, you know? Why? How material is that to how we are going to finance the expenditure needs of the country and meet the obligations that we have? Because that's what a budget debate is supposed to be about. It's supposed to be about, are your priorities really right? Are your priorities right? Is your spending focused on the things that will matter most and produce the most impact for the benefit of the public of the Bahamas? Or do I disagree? Would I have put more money in this area than that area? That's the debate. That's what the debate is supposed to be over. Do I question whether you are being credible in your budget forecast, revenue forecast? That's the debate. Am I really clear on how you're going to finance this borrowing that you say you need to have? That's the budget debate. No. We won't bust people, but because they say something about the about $2 million transfer to an NGO. And I have to say, listen, unless the prime minister and those have some substantial reason to believe that something nefarious went on, I mean, this is a non-issue to me, non-issue. Now, it is an issue as to how you could have such an error occur, and you better make sure you could prevent that error from occurring. So I would expect that an internal audit and perhaps even an audit, well, I know the Auditor General has already done something in the way of this. So did the Auditor General suggest that there was anything nefarious going on in that regard? No, the money was returned. It was sent to an NGO. An NGO has obligations under the Act in terms of the way it proceeds with these things. So why? So once again, we get put to us, largely to my mind, a non-issue in the midst of substantial issues. Now, if you are a citizen of the Bahamas listening today, you're a resident of the Bahamas listening today, you are an investor in the Bahamas listening today, you are in the international community listening today, you when you go and listen to a budget debate, what would you like to hear when you listen to that debate? I'm asking you all now. I'm asking you all, before I talk about what I'd like to hear, I'm asking you all, what would you think is relevant, appropriate, important to hear in a budget debate? Can you help me with that, folks? Please, I have a caller on the line. Go ahead, caller, we're listening to you. Hi, go ahead, caller. No? Well, producer told me I had a caller. All right, I'm sorry, caller, you could call back if we lost you. What is it that you would expect to hear listening to a budget debate? What would give you a sense of clarity about the circumstances, present and the future, about the government's finances? And just remember, when we're dealing with the budget, we're only dealing with the government's finances, not the country's, the government's. Okay? We've got a caller. Go ahead, caller. We're listening to you.
Hi, good day.
Hi, how you doing?
Fine, thank you. I have a question.
Sure.
The $2 million that was found with the NGO, did they find that on their own and returned it, or did the government found it was missing and requested that they returned it?
You know, ma'am, that's a good question. I don't know, because I raised that in another show. Because I remembered, I used the example that one time I had a double payment made to me of, I was supposed to get paid $5,000, but I ended up with $10,000. And so I spotted it immediately, called the people and said, listen, man, you all made a double payment. So, and then they discovered it. And I said to them, I reversed the payment the same day, within the hour. And that was, so I don't know, it's a good question, but I know it was sitting there for days or so, right? So clearly someone didn't pick it up for a little while.
You said it was sitting there for days.
Yeah, that's my recollection, that it was there for some while.
Okay, so my thing is, so it probably was there until the NGO did their books and realized that they had too much money there. And I'm trying to figure, somebody needs to find out from the government if this money was willingly found out and returned. Because, I mean, in all fairness, I know Dr. Mendez is running out right now with what he's carrying on with. But I feel his pain, because I can feel the fact that he feels like they're trying to call him a thief.
No, I agree 100% that this is a non-issue. It's a non-issue. I mean,
Yes. Listen,
because if even if the government discovered that this $2 million was nefariously sent, then the government has an obligation to do something about it. But that wasn't what the prime minister said. The prime minister and the minister of finance didn't say this was unethical or nefarious. He just said we discovered.
Okay, so $2 million. My thing is, because I mean, I've been listening from they came in, and I can be honest with you. I'm a regular person in the country who is just listening to what's going on. And the way I see it is like they're putting fun, I mean, these large numbers out there. Okay, like the $1 billion that was unaccounted for or whatever they said. And I'm trying to figure out, okay, so what's with this $1 billion? Where is it? Who has it? Where was it supposed to go?
No, that was the way that was stated was a little bit of a curiosity, quite frankly. And it's not a matter of money missing. It wasn't a matter of money being mishandled. It was a question of judgment or discretion about what to include in the pre-election fiscal report and what not to include. It wasn't a question that nobody...
I understand that later, but when I initially heard it, the first thing I thought of is, wow, you know, what kind of thievery going on in here?
Yes, exactly. That's the impression.
So my thing is, the way they are reading off these things, I think they need to be very careful because, you know, we live in a very funny world, today for me, tomorrow for you. You know what I mean? So don't make it, you making these statements that's making the public assume that Dr. Minnis and his administration were a bunch of thieves and crooks and robbers. Mm-hmm. And I don't think that was, this is why Dr. Minnis gets so upset, because he feels like what he did was, what he felt was right for the time. You understand? And they come back here and you making these statements to make these assumptions that they were just up to no good. And that's wrong. If you're going to make a statement and say, okay, we find the money, however, we didn't went looking for it. The persons discovered it and they returned it willingly and said it was an honest mistake. But you come with your statement and leave it like that, you leave me with a lot of wondering, and I'm trying to draw my own conclusion. I'm still trying to draw my own conclusion from this $1 billion. And every time they talk, I'm still trying to draw my conclusion from something else because they're not clarifying anything. They're just dropping it and leaving it. And let you figure out for yourself. That's wrong.
Well, the information I'm getting is that it was that the NGO did discover it and then returned the money. That's what I'm told. And
why didn't they tell the public that one time rather than trying to make it look like somebody was hiding this money?
This is what I'm being told. Okay, so better information exists out there. That's what I'm being told.
That's what it seems like to me. It doesn't seem like the Auditor General find this money. It's like returned it once they discovered it.
Here's the thing, right? Like you're calling me, and this is the point that I'm making in the show. You're calling me, and listen to what we're talking about. We're talking about $2 million that was returned to the government of the Bahamas, notwithstanding we have a budget debate on billions of dollars and hundreds of millions of dollars in loans that have to be made and secured.
And there is nothing much discussed about that.
This is my point. This is the whole show today is about what it is that we should be hearing in respect of the budget debate. What should be the dominant discussion in the budget debate? For instance, a cabinet minister should report on the progress of revenue and expenditure in his or her ministry, the programs and the results of that spending for the benefit of the public. This is what the budget debate is supposed to be about.
And that is what I totally agree with. However, they are consuming the House time, the person's time, the public time, the air time, and all they can do with a bunch of pointing fingers and laying blame and then giggling at it at the end of the day, like they just win some battle. And that's wrong. You go on in there to do a job. Let me know what's going on with the country. Let me know if we're moving forward. Let me know if we're dropping behind. Let me know where the growth is coming in and what's the next step to try and get these persons paid off for roads and parks and all this other stuff. You're not discussing these things. You just
That responsibility falls not just on the government side. You know, it's the opposition that's supposed to also herald the fact that if this is not being done, you're not telling us this, you're not telling us that. What about this? What about that? So it's both sides.
It is. And I blame all of them. You know, they go in there and they go in there with a plan, and then they get sidetracked, and then buff, everything goes down drain. They need to focus all of that.
I appreciate you calling, ma'am. Thank you very much. We have another caller on the line. Go ahead, caller. We're listening to you. Hi, how you doing?
Mr. Laing, with all respect, right, that's a lie.
What is a lie?
Not you. I said the money was discovered by the Auditor General, okay?
Okay. You say the money was discovered by the Auditor General?
Okay, that's a lie, okay? And for the moment, that lady was getting paid $7,000.
Hold on, brother. Listen to me. Let me tell you hold on a minute. Hold a minute for me, please. What's not going to happen is you're not going to... Don't let's bulldoze past a point, because I don't do the show like that. Okay, let me ask you. So you're saying the Auditor General discovered that the money was in that account and then they sent it back? How do you know that?
All right, they thieving, okay?
Excuse me? All right, thank you, man. Thanks, brother. Thanks. Let's move on, folks. Ladies and gentlemen, we're going to take a break. You're listening to Z Live. I'm Zhivargo Laing, your host. We'll be back after this break.
In relationship banking, we take pride in getting to know our clients. You have access to knowledgeable, approachable ambassadors and financial coaches so that we can recommend the best product for you. At Fidelity, we care about you. From your financial health to your physical health, we can relate to you because we're just like you. Come and start your relationship banking experience with us today. Visit us online at fidelitygroup.com. Visit any of our branches in Nassau or Grand Bahama, or phone 356-7764 in Nassau, or 352-6676 for Freeport.
Sheila, you okay? I see smoke coming from your window.
Chad, Johnny Moe's burning down the house frying chicken.
Your kitchen is a mess. You have insurance?
If I have insurance, I pull my phone out, pull up the Royal Star Assurance app, and in no time, I was on live chat with RSA rep, sent pics of the damage, filed my claim on the spot.
Wow, I don't think my insurance got that kind of...
You gotta go to RSA for that.
Download the RSA app today. Live chat available weekdays 9 to 5.
One thing there is no debate about is that BTC has the best rates. Now, the best rates just got better because you pay half the price of the other guys with your BTC home internet and mobile services combined. Switching to BTC is a no-brainer because I pay less with BTC and get super fast internet with speeds up to 600 megs. The other guys, their internet only go up to 105 megs.
Get all the internet you want at half the price when you bundle your home internet and mobile. Visit a BTC store to make the switch today. Conditions apply.
This is Guardian Radio 96.9 FM, Nassau, Bahamas.
I'm not afraid. Take a stand. Everybody, come take my hand. We'll walk this road together through the storm. Whatever weather, cold or warm, send you know that you're not alone. Holla if you feel like you make it down the same road.
Welcome back, ladies. Gentlemen, to Z Live. I'm Zhivargo Laing, your host. So glad that you could join us here today on Guardian Radio 96.9 FM on this beautiful Wednesday afternoon. I trust that you are doing well. You can call us on 323-6232 or 325-4316 or 325-4259. You can text us on 422-4796 or WhatsApp me on 439-3043. All right, we got a caller on the line. Go ahead, caller, we're listening to you.
Yeah, pleasure. Good afternoon, Mr. Laing. I hope you're doing well, sir.
Yeah, I'm doing great, man. Yourself?
I'm good. Mr. Laing, good. I remember a time, long time ago, when I would have sat down and listened to debates going on in the House of Assembly, when people like A.F. Adley and them would get up and speak. And last year or year before last, when Peter Turnquest was leaving and was doing the budget debate. Mm-hmm. And I mean, I called Warren Short. I told him, you know, the budget debate is for the budget. It speaks to the financial issues. I mean, they were all over the place. For one, I think they were talking about BPL at one time, and they just keep talking about what you did when you were in power, and you did that and this, that. And I said, woman, what is going on in this House of Assembly? These are money matters. This is the people's money. When it comes to the budget debate, it should be focused on the issue. You were budgeted X amount of money. What did you do with it? How did you spend it? What do you have to hear from you. I don't want to hear from all you when you were in power, you all did this and all kind of things. You need to have a school for these parliamentarians, man. Somebody need to.
Well, you know, brother, a school ain't gonna help, you know. A schooling ain't help. Let me tell you why. What is necessary is if politicians really, really felt that the public didn't have an appetite for that kind of discussion, they wouldn't do it.
Yeah, but I mean, I don't think, you know, most people on the most part don't even care about these kind of things. Anyhow.
Exactly.
On the average part, it's like people just trying to live, trying to get by. So it ain't that, you know, but I'm saying for the small minority of persons who may be concerned, you know, they should at least do it for them. But for the most of the part, the average Bahamian doesn't care but what really goes on. And you know, they want to satisfy their base, whoever's in party. I mean, in politics, they just want to, you know, say what this one did and what we find and whatever. If they found something that was wrong, send it to the police, let the police deal with it, right? You come and speak to the matters of money. You know, this is what we need. This is what is facing us now as a country. This is the way forward. How are we going to deal with it? And so on, man. And keep focus on what you were there for, because time is very short. In a couple of months now, it'll be like the end of the year, and then you look around and nothing will be accomplished. So thanks for your time.
Thank you, brother. I appreciate you calling. We have another caller on the line. Go ahead, caller. We're listening to you.
Hello.
Go ahead, caller.
Hello. Good afternoon, Mr. Laing. How you doing?
Hey, Ray Sparky. What's up?
I'm talking to your family. Doing well, sir.
Thank you, man.
Following up on what the last caller just said about, you know, sitting back and listening to this gimmick backward and forward and pointing fingers at one another. I even wondered, why did the former prime minister come up and mention the fact that he's used three different signatures? What was that important for in this financial debate?
That's what he says, Barry?
Why is he saying that he's used three different signatures? So which signature is your real signature? What's the real one? When you sign one, is that a fake signature?
But that have to do with the government, though?
I'm trying to find out. Well, why did he even bring that up? So he's used three different signatures. I wonder how much different signatures Brad is used.
thank you, buddy, man. Listen. Now, you remember the caller called and said that the Auditor General discovered the $2 million? Okay, this is the former prime minister. Now, listen, you could say what you want to say. I don't know if you want to believe him or not, but this is what he said happened. He says, an unfortunate event had happened and some of the monies were misquoted by NGOs in their financial systems. Dr. Minnis said, they were misquoted and as a result of that request, would have been made for money to keep the food running to feed Bahamians who were in need, which was an emergency. They subsequently, with time, realized that some monies were misquoted. Government was contacted as to how to return the monies since they were misquoted, but not at one time was any of the money used by NGOs for any personal use or misappropriation. He says the monies were subsequently returned to the government. But you know, and I know, that the hardest thing in the world to do is to return monies to the government. Okay? So he said, Davis and his government need to be very careful when they are trying to impugn the reputation and blah, blah, blah. Okay? So according to the former prime minister, it was the NGOs that discovered that they had more money sent to them than was required. They contacted the government to say that they had done so. And then to ask how the money should be returned. Where is the Auditor General in that information? If you could find me some information that say the Auditor General discovered this, because first of all, if anybody knows how an Auditor General works, the Auditor General works on historic information. I have all kind of accountant friends out there. One of y'all accountant friends of mine, you could write me and tell me. The Auditor General, auditors work on historical stuff for the most part. So they'd be looking at what happened with the with the financial transactions, right? So what Auditor General sitting down live can be sitting down and say, oh, you know what? Y'all got too much money on this account, you know. That's not usual. That's all I'm saying. That's not usual, lead the way it tends to work. But my larger point is, what would you wish to hear in the budget debates? What would you like to hear in this budget debate? This says, said he did say that this texter, say rebutting Braves issue with non-matching signatures on beaches and parks talking. Well, okie dokie. This text, let me get some of your texts here. This text says, what I feel is important are specifics on how certain economic policies will be implemented, the time frame, and how that these policies help my circumstances as a mere citizen. Very good point. Very good. This text says the tit for tat and the blame game that keeps happening in both administrations is old and does not resolve any issues. It's a waste of time, precious time that can be used in the parliament to troubleshoot and to do things different that will have a significant impact on increasing our revenues, reducing our debt, and improving the life of the ordinary citizens. They need to stop playing the political games. Very well said. This text says, I think we're being too lax on the issue of missing controls. Today it's $2 million. Next time it'll be $100 million because it's only an error, right? What is the responsibility of the board? Can they be sued? I find it unbelievable that a board member, not to mention three or four reviewing a financial statement, doesn't notice a $2 million blip. It's like people are accepting these board postings as status symbols and free money with zero thought of their responsibility. But you obviously didn't listen to what I just said. They discovered that the money was in excess of what it ought to have been, and they contacted the government. So what are you now saying? They were the ones who discovered it, apparently, according to the former prime minister, and I didn't hear anybody dispute that. So they discovered it, right? So why now are you impugning board members and this kind of stuff? And we hear raised that the fact that an error occurred means that you have to find out how could such an error occur. And what the former prime minister said was that in response to NGOs' request for funding for the people that they were feeding, they submitted the request to the government and the government subsequently funded them. That's what happened. So that's not earth shattering. Now you could ask the question, well, what was the verification used to support the request in the first instance? You could ask questions about that. That's what internal controls are supposed to do. This text says, Mr. Laing, the fact that the funds were sent back where they originated, I think the problem mushrooms when the chair lady went public with her version. Okie dokie. This says, Kwesi was on fire and revealed a lot of things, especially how the government would cut the budget for education, armed forces, local government, public services, et cetera, is mind-blowing. Well, how would Kwesi know if the government is cutting the budget? First of all, when the government submits the budget estimate, you know right in the estimate what the funding situation is. So if you're saying to me, Kwesi pointed out that there are cuts in the budget, that's a different story. But if you say will be, as in he expects sometimes, think of that's a different story. We have a call on the line. Go ahead, caller. We're listening to you.
Hello, Mr. Laing. How are you today? Hello?
I'm doing great, ma'am. And yourself?
Oh, wonderful.
Good.
I'm trying to figure out why, when the questions was asked, when the Progressive Liberal Party was in opposition, the same questions with basically in reference to what Mr. Davis is laying on the table. The FNM never brought forth these questions, never answered the question.
Right.
In terms of how the food program, the contributions will be, you know, never answered
right.
repeatedly.
Right.
They're in opposition, but
right.
asking the question.
Right.
And another thing again, like the full layout. I mean, many in the country today, I believe, were surprised to know that the persons were being paid, some of the NGOs, a salary.
Okay.
The transparency and accountability is basically thrown out the window when it comes to this food distribution. I think even Mr. Davis and others, and like myself, all this could have been avoided.
Let me ask you a question. How much are the boards of all the appointed boards of the country being paid?
Well, I don't know. They said what, $7,000?
No. I'm asking you a different question. All the appointments that were made by the Davis administration, including the diplomatic appointments, do you know how much those people are being paid?
No, my point is, I'll answer like this, right? You're asking me a question, but basically something I'm saying to you. My point is, it was asked. Dr. Minister said transparency in the car. It was asked. I think this is a different reference to what I'm trying to make. I'm not talking about board now. I'm talking about the full food contributions.
Ma'am, listen to me a minute, please. Seriously. Listen, let's not play games. Honestly, I ain't gonna lie to you. I don't want to play games. You raise a good point. But I don't want to play games. I'm not going to do that, right? We know. We know on both sides of the political divide, on the administrations, we know that people get appointed to do things, they are paid, and no one says a word.
But I didn't know the NGOs were being paid.
Don't know that many boards are being paid.
You
don't know that at all.
Irrelevant. To you, that particular thing what Mr. Davis said may be irrelevant. One more point. Don't hang me up. I want to make another point. I would say welcome to the world of politics.
Yes, ma'am.
The incoming government comes in.
Yes.
And they talk about with the other government and they lay things on the table. That's not unique to the Bahamas.
Yes.
The person's calling in, I go on with the business. We won't hear that. Blah, blah, blah. This is the most I ever hear that.
No, stop that. Stop it.
No.
Listen, you talking to me. You know I've been in there for 10 years.
I'm not saying everybody. All right?
No, but I'm saying you say this is the most you ever hear. Don't do that.
That's why I say welcome to the world of politics. I'm not distinguishing.
You're right about that.
I'm not doing that distinction. I said welcome to the world of politics.
You're right
all
about that.
All over the world, an incoming government will talk some things about the former, just like 1992. The Linden government.
Even up to the present time. You're right about that.
I'm not just thinking between only PLCs and FNF.
But that don't have nothing to do with what I'm talking about today. I'm saying that we have a budget debate. It shouldn't be dominated by a $2 million erroneous transfer. I'm asking, what should it be about? And that's what I'm asking people to tell me.
Should it be about? I'm not disputing that at all. Yes, moving forward, how the country, the economic and stuff, I agree with that. But what I'm saying to you, welcome to the world of politics. We're not new at this. So whatever carrier, yes, it should be. In a perfect political, whatever world we're living in, that's a perfect world. What we want?
Yeah, but I'm not the one.
That's
who's
how I see it.
But I'm not the one caught up in whether they are talking about what did happen, because that's not my point at all. Because I said that you can get that. That's politics. You can get some of that, right? What I'm talking about is what people should be looking at. What should we be looking at substantially in the budget debate? So you're right. It's politics. That's how it go. But it can't be the whole of politics, because that's not everybody plays it that way. Ladies and gentlemen, you're listening to Z Live. I'm Zhivargo Laing, your host. We're going to pay our respects to our sponsors. We'll be back after this break.
Take a stand.
If you're looking to diversify your portfolio, chart a course for RF Mutual Funds, where you can get global returns through our suite of internationally invested funds. Get exposure in US, Asian, European, and emerging markets without central bank approval. And with financial services leader Morgan Stanley as the advisor of our international funds, you can benefit from RF's global connections. Set sail for international markets today by visiting rfgroup.com. RF, money at work.
The Water and Sewage Corporation advises its customers in New Providence and the Family Islands that the corporation will commence mass disconnections beginning Monday, March 28, 2022, on all outstanding accounts and financial agreements. Customers who have not honored their financial agreements are advised to visit their local offices to update those agreements as soon as possible. And all customers are further advised to bring their accounts up to date to avoid the disconnection of their water and sewage services without further notice.
This is Guardian Radio 96.9 FM. Fresh news, smart talk, all day.
I'm not afraid, I'm not afraid to take a stand.
Ladies and gentlemen, to Z Live. I'm Zhivargo Laing, your host. So glad you could join us today. We got a caller on the line. Go ahead, caller. We're listening to you.
Hey, good day. How you doing, Zhivargo?
Hey, I'm right here, man. And yourself?
Okay. I don't want to get so much into the people what they saying, but I want to get to your point. What they should be doing, or what would you like them?
Right. Well, right, yeah. What you would like to hear being discussed?
I think like this kind of like a good opportunity for them to make this scenario a cookie cutter scenario. So in the event that we have some kind of disaster or that I need disaster relief, and we have to set up all these, you know, payments and all, you know, requests and all that stuff or whatever, they should have this, use that opportunity or this opportunity now as a dry run and go to say, okay, when you putting in as an NGO and you requesting this, whatever it is you need, then we need this to quantify or verify what you're asking for is correct. Mm-hmm. And then mm-hmm. we'll move from there. So in order for us to distribute any funds, we'll need X, Y, and Z. You understand? So that's
yeah,
one of the things I think they should take this opportunity, and that'll leave some of that rigor and back and forth. You know what I mean? Like, which don't, like you say, all of us agree that don't make sense, but they use that opportunity to throw dots at one another for, you know, for political points, to bring the other person down or put them to shame or whatever, you know, anything.
Right.
So we both do that. So they both do that. So like I say, those type of things, yeah, and across the board, not only for disasters, for anything. And I remember working in hotels. If you needed anything for one of the rooms, that go, if it was maintenance, housekeeping, or whatever, they go to the request form you had to put in. You put that in, and that go to whatever department it needed to go to. And then their auditor, but the whole accounts or administration and accounts with, you know, they do the math on it. When they say the math, person did the job, that's X amount of billable hours, this was the product used, that's X, they needed this to do it. All that come out on the report. So, I mean, and it ain't, and that's generic. So that, in case of some kind of extra thing, you had to run out right away and buy that with cash money, then that go to the petty cash. You understand? So all this stuff, this ain't nothing new. They do this every day. They do it for the NFL. They do it for everybody's doing it. So I don't understand why we as a government running a whole country with billions of dollars can't seem to figure it out. You know what I mean?
Let's also be honest though. We are running a country with billions of dollars, and billions of those dollars are spent, and you don't have this issue. So this is like a $2 million of a $2 billion budget.
Right.
So let's not pretend that this is the whole, look at how many thousands of people get paid by the government every single day, and nobody's complaining that, oh, you oversend me money, you undersend me money, blah, 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 blah. That's not a big part of the system.
Right, But I understand it, Zhivargo, and I'm not disagreeing with you that that doesn't happen. And I'm sure it is happening in every organization. But like I say, I'm just saying we should take this time or this opportunity
to discuss how you're strengthening the system.
Right. You understand.
I got you. Make good sense. Makes good sense.
Okay.
All right. We got another call on the line. Go ahead, caller. We're listening to you.
So, Mr. Laing.
Yes, sir. Yes.
You can hear me. You're a little low.
Yeah, but I don't know. I wasn't a little low to everybody else, though. You sound good to me. Go ahead.
A lot of people made me go on and get their stuff yesterday, but I just want to tell you thanks for allowing me to cry the other day to say we didn't get paid. That's like over a month now since I had to talk to you. Some of them people who's waiting and all still ain't get paid, because I tell you Tuesday they just call people to come back down for BG Park to bring their stuff. Thank you. Something to come true. But what it was Monday evening around 7:30, wait till the next
good.
Day to get
good. Paid. Good. Excellent. I'm glad to hear
you. Could I answer your question, please?
Yeah, man, please go right ahead.
Okay. Before I do, the lady will tell you, but welcome to the world of politics, although you hear nothing new to you. Lady, let me tell you something. Look here, you know what? Not the name and shame game, but it's good for them to expose and let us know what the former government do. Anytime we have a new government coming, right? It's all about, this is how I see it, this is how I look at it, Lady L. It's like them abusing their power and the new government coming in and letting us know. But what the new government, what this new day government need to do for us, you're talking about welcome to the new to a politics, what y'all need to do for us is stop this foolishness. Fix the problem. When I say fix the problem, I know nothing is perfect, always room for improvement, but make it more difficult for these politicians to abuse their power. Make it more consequences for them when they don't do this. They him coming in there and talking about this one and that one doing. I mean, we can't that kind of sustain. All right, make it more. What it is? Repercussion, consequences when they do this action. Make it more difficult to discourage them from wanting to abuse their power. Mr. Lai, you said what we could use for the government. What I like to hear in the budget. What I like to hear, right? Not too much of handouts, although plenty of people are just suffering, like with the NIV, with the groceries and the money. Yeah, that could help people, right? But when you want people to live with their dignity, let's think out of the box. I like the Minister of Finance to say in this budget that we can allocate some funds, millions of dollars, to invest in farming. Even if we have to take all of these, the majority of us who are here, and go on the ferry to the family island, come back every 2 days or whatsoever, make it feasible that we can do things them that we can help them while they down to pay their rent and buy groceries, but they'll be working at the same time, learning something we can never take away from them, and helping the management of the economy or the cost of living in the country when it comes down to buying food. We'll be able to try to attempt to deal with that situation. Then what he could do, if he really serious, Brave Davis, if you really serious, my new government, let me give you a challenge out of politicians to say they give you a challenge. Prime Minister, be brave. Take the rot off the medicine and the bread crust, Ivan Frost, please. We begging you. If you want to do something for us, you're talking to Fred Minister, but come out there and serve the Prime Minister's support. He don't need no support for us. What he need to do is listen to us. We ask him to remove the rot for a little while till we catch ourselves. Okay? That's all we need. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you, Papa. Papa, boy, I can tell you one thing. Papa's always passionate in his plea for us to change and do things a little different. Do we have another call on the line? We have that's a minute before the break. No. Now, somebody had texted that Kwesi said that national security was being cut and this sum is being cut. Now, let me tell you all, the government does propose in the media budget that national security actually increases, not cut. It goes from $12.2 million to $14.3 million, almost over $2 million increase, and that education, the Department of Education, has a $2.1 million cut. It goes from $202 million to $204 million. That's like about 1% cut, right? I think that's hardly a glitch, hardly any significant change for that department, because any of these departments having that much money could waste that much money. So I'm not sure what the big hullabaloo would necessarily be in those cuts. Anyway, ladies and gentlemen, we have to take a break for news. When we come back, we'll continue our discussion. You're listening to Z Live. I'm Zhivargo Laing, your host. We'll be back after this news break. Take a stand. Everybody, everybody.
This is Guardian Radio, 96.9 FM, Nassau, Bahamas.
You're listening to News Headlines on the Hour over the Guardian Radio Network. Good afternoon, everybody. I'm Jared Higgs. Thanks so much for joining us. Here's what our news team is working on. Prime Minister Philip Brave Davis revealed in Parliament today that Susan Holowesko-Larson, who chaired the National Food Security Task Force, was paid $1,750 per week for her work. Davis told parliamentarians that he was surprised that Holowesko-Larson was being paid for her work, as he thought the job was a voluntary one.
Mrs. Susan Holowesko-Larson, the chairwoman of the National Food Security Task Force, was hired by the government and paid a salary of $7,000 a month and or $1,750 per week. Did we know that? Did anyone expect that?
Davis added that in addition to her salary, while setting up the program, Holowesko-Larson indicated to people on a Zoom call that she was also reserving 9% of the total amount spent to cover administration fees. Davis said that would amount to $4.7 million. He once again questioned why there was a complete absence of records on the spending of the $53 million allocated to the program. In other news, Catholic Archbishop Patrick Pinder yesterday expressed support for criminalizing marital rape, noting that forced sexual activity within a marriage is a distortion of the biblical understanding of marriage. Archbishop Pinder, while speaking at a forum at the University of Bahamas over Zoom, noted that the conversation surrounding marital rape is not easy, but is necessary. He said the radical equality between men and women is laid out in the Bible.
When an individual is forced to engage in sexual activity against his or her will, then the perpetrator does violence to the dignity and value of the human person created in the image and likeness of God. When forced sexual activity takes place within the context of marriage, the biblical understanding of marriage is distorted and the relationship between husband and wife is ruptured.
Family members and police tell the Nassau Guardian that the decomposed body found in well fields in the Carmichael area had the identification card of Robert Bethel Sr., a 79-year-old taxi driver who went missing last August. A ring belonging to Bethel was also found on the body, according to the man's relatives. However, there has been no positive identification of the body that was discovered. A relative of Bethel Sr. has provided a DNA sample that has been sent off to the United States along with a sample from the remains. According to police, a 79-year-old was last seen leaving his residence at number 37 New Hope Drive at 4:30 a.m. on August 21st, 2021. Family members say they communicated with him by phone later that day and he had plans to do an airport drop-off. Relatives don't know if he made that trip or what happened to him since. His taxi, a 2001 Toyota Regius, was also missing. You were listening to News Headlines on the Hour over the Guardian Radio Network. On behalf of the entire news team, I'm Jared Higgs. Thanks so much for joining us. Tune in at the top of every hour for the latest news updates.
How important collecting your money can be to the success of your business. Start your relationship with Fidelity today so that we can show you the many options available to you with our merchant services. From click and pay options online to merchant terminal commerce options, we're here to help your business succeed. For more details, speak to one of our business development officers at 356-7764 in Nassau or 352-6676 in Freeport. Visit our website at fidelitygroup.com or visit any of our branches. Fidelity, we're good
for you. I'm Ed Donahue with an AP News Minute. In an attempt to tame inflation, the Federal Reserve is raising its benchmark short-term interest rate and signaling potentially up to 7 rate hikes this year. President Biden says the U.S. is providing more support, $800 million more, to help shore up Ukraine's air defenses against Russia.
This could be a long and difficult battle,
But the American people will be steadfast in our support of the people of Ukraine in the face of Putin's immoral, unethical attacks on civilian populations.
Speaking to Congress through an interpreter, Ukrainian President Volodymyr Zelensky says these days are like bad days in U.S. history.
Remember Pearl Harbor, terrible morning of December 7, 1941, when your sky was black from the planes attacking you. Just remember it. Remember September the 11th.
Zelensky again pushed for a no-fly zone over Ukraine. I'm Ed Donahue.
This is Guardian Radio, 96.9 FM, Nassau, Bahamas.
I'm not afraid, I'm not afraid to take a stand.
Welcome back, ladies and gentlemen, to Z Live. I'm Zhivargo Laing, your host. So glad you could join us here today on Guardian Radio 96.9 FM on this beautiful Wednesday afternoon. I trust that you are doing well. If you want to give us a call, the numbers are 323-6232 or 325-4316 or 325-4259. You can text us on 422-4796 or WhatsApp me on 439-3043. We have a number of texts here. I want to get them read for you. Somebody is lying. I ain't calling nobody names. Somebody is lying. Say the money was discovered by the NGO, not the Auditor General. Mr. Davis in the House of Assembly said Obi Bilchkam called him and said they send the money, more money. I think we're being too lax on the issue of missing controls. Today it's too many. Yeah, we read that before. This text says, Mr. Laing, the fact that the funds were sent back. Oh, no, sorry. This text says that is completely different explanation than what Susan Larson gave. Susan Larson said the NGO didn't know the money was there and just discovered it after some exercise. Minnis, on the other hand, is saying that the NGO realized they had more than they needed and tried to return some of it. Susan Larson's words are right here in the newspaper. She said that, in quote, the disbursements that were issued to Hands for Hunger were mistakenly coded incorrectly by their financial officer, she said. She said, in quote, and so instead of a deposit that they received showing on the balance sheet of the task force project that they were running, that money or those deposits showed up elsewhere, is what she said. And so it is a mistake for the prime minister to say that the NGO in question held on to money. It was a mistake. The disbursements made to the NGO was simply miscoded. That's what she is saying, okay? This text says, yes, I know how the NGOs got money. I explained it from the first time Davis brought it up. The NGOs had to provide an estimate of persons served and got funds based on their estimate. My question at the time was, if the NGO was aware that their actuals were below estimate, why were the amounts never reduced? They got funds in installments. I don't recall if it was monthly or quarterly. A $2 million overage suggests multiple overpayments. Well, that could follow from the explanation. If let's be real, right? People ain't tracking money like they mightn't be tracking the overall financial picture from day to day. What they're trying to do is, do I have the cash to purchase this and fund that and so forth and so forth. And then as you do an assessment, maybe a quarterly assessment or something, you kind of find out, something's amiss here. So that's not unusual. Come on, please. Says, good afternoon, Mr. Laing. I know and understand the rationale of the political investigation currently being discussed, but I wish we would talk about food and energy security or how we can incorporate those concepts into a sustainable development program for government, okay? It's Texas. Hello, Mr. Laing. I think the budget debate should be about the finances of the country, forecasts on spending and strategies for the way forward. The tone of the debate, I fear, should be set by those in the House. Stay focused on the matters at hand because this is a serious business. If they do, the citizens will follow. Lead by example. Very well said. They see Liar Crazy was quoting from the fiscal strategy report. These cuts would come in July 2022. But this fiscal strategy report doesn't have the detailed estimates of expenditure. So how would he know? How would he know that? Okay, you don't know what the government's July budget is going to be. So anyway, maybe there's an avenue he has that I don't have. Anyways, you know, there are details about the budget and the estimates. So you can go and get the estimates. You could go, like if you, here's how I do it. This is the quickest way I do it. You can Google search Bahamas government. Once you do that, you can click on any of the items that say Bahamas government website. You go to the Bahamas government website, and then when you go down the left-hand column, you will see a number of items. One of those items will be in the upper windows. It'll be agency site services permits. And then one of those items would be national budget. If you click on the national budget, you'll go to the national budget page. And then you can go down the page and you'll see the mid 2021-2022 mid-year budget statement and all the documents related to the mid-year budget, inclusive of what is called the draft estimates of revenue and expenditure. Once you click that, you'll get the details of all the revenue, details of all the expenditure, details for all the ministries, all the departments, all the spendings related to those, and then you could know for yourself what it is the government is proposing to do in the way of cuts or not. So according to the mid-year budget estimates, the government plans to spend $2,879,209,441. How is that different than what was originally estimated and proposed in July of 2020? One, it is higher than what was proposed. In July of 2021, the government had proposed to spend $2,825,918,296. It now proposes to spend $53,291,145,000 more than in the last budget estimates. I want you to hear me. So the adjusted numbers now put overall government spending at $53,291,145 more than was estimated in July in the budget presented in June of last year. So the government proposes to spend more. So even if it makes a cut in an area, it is spending more money. It proposes to spend more money than was originally estimated by the Minister administration in June of 2021. Insofar as revenue is concerned, the government expects in this adjusted budget, it expects to take in $2,336,800,000. And that represents an increase of just under $100 million in revenue. So the government expects to have a higher revenue and higher expenditure than it did. And it expects to have more revenue in this revised budget than it had proposed in the June estimates that were presented. and it proposes to have more expenditure than in that budget. The overall deficit it is expecting is going to be about $100 million less than was proposed in the June budget. So it expects a better deficit situation, still $858.6 million in deficit, almost $1 billion, but not the $951.8 billion that was planned for in June of 2021. Right? So overall, the difference is better in terms of what the forecast of deficit is, but it's not substantially better, but it is better. On the one hand, there was a 7.7% forecast of GFS deficit. Now it's 7.4%, so 0.3% difference, not a big difference, but some difference nonetheless, and a difference in a better way, okay? This is the kind of dialogue that you can get and hear and should get and hear about your budget debate, what the numbers mean, what the numbers are doing. Somebody should go and say to you, the reason why I am forecasting almost $100 million more in revenue is because I expect revenue improvements in this area, the next area, and so forth and so forth. Like I expect to take in largely $80 million in VAT, better than I thought I would take in, because that's what they're proposing. I expect to take in $11 million more in trade taxes and transaction taxes. So those two could pretty much cover the $92 million increase in revenue that is being forecasted. That's it. That's where. So they will say to you, the reason why I am expecting better revenue outcomes, almost $100 million, is because I expect to collect $80 million more in VAT, and I expect to collect $80 million more in trade taxes. That would be custom duty and them so forth and so forth. You know, so you get to know that information. Then they'd go down to expenditure and say to you, well, you know, what I'm proposing in expenditure, so that you are aware, is as follow, right? This is you, because you're giving people information now, right? You say to them, when it comes to expenditure, I expect to spend $53 million more because I'm going to increase $19 million to Ministry of Public Service, and that provision I'm making is for this purpose. I'm going to increase the Office of the Prime Minister by $6.7 million, and that's going to be for this purpose. I'm going to increase the Ministry of Finance's provision by $31 million, and that's for this purpose. This is what you should be told. I'm going to increase national security by $2 million, and it's for this reason. I'm going to increase Ministry of Works and Utilities by $7.7 million for this reason. Right? Similarly, though, you say, but while I'm doing that, I am going to decrease the Department of Education by $2 million. I'm going to decrease the Department of Public Service by $25,000, and so forth and so forth. And explain why. Why the change? Ministry of Economic Affairs is going to get $12.5 million more than it got in the previous estimate. Why? Because you bring some of the departments into their space, or what? What's the reason for that? This is the explanations that you would expect from the public. This is a debate. Then the opposition might be able to say, but we don't agree with your reasons for doing that increase or that decrease. We think you ought to have done this. We think you ought to have done that better. We had proposed X, Y, and Z, and we proposed it because X, Y, and Z. That's the budget debate. That's the debate you want to have. Yes, you could bring up the $2 million, because the Prime Minister does raise some points largely around how much you're being, that I didn't know. The Prime Minister says he didn't know that the chairman and the chairperson of the committee was being paid. But that ain't the chairperson's fault, right? That's not the chairperson's fault. And let's be clear. I mean, honestly, let's be clear, right? Prime Minister and those know that many things the government of the Bahamas does It doesn't give details to the public about who gets paid what. You know that, right? We know that. I mean, this isn't just the Minnis administration. It's not just the Davis administration. It would be the Ingram administration. You know, we appoint ambassadors all the time. Any of y'all know how much the ambassadors get paid? Anybody? You don't, right? We get board appointments. You don't typically know what the boards get paid. And that disclosure should and could be done. There should be no reason for any of those things to be a secret, okay? And so as a point of, say, gotcha politics, or a point of, I'm gonna embarrass you, you know, it'll have an effect, that's for sure. I mean, there's no question. If it's a political point, it can have an effect. But in material terms, it's not something that's substantially different than what is done in the Commonwealth of the Bahamas on a regular basis. On a regular basis. These executive chairmanships at these corporations, how much do they get paid? You don't know. We don't know. We haven't known for years, for decades. Those of us who've been inside know. But again, you know, as a matter of politics, hey, buddy, I'm not going to stop anybody from playing the politics and doing the politics. But the budget debate substantially now is about how the public funds that are sought to be raised will be spent to the benefit of the public. That's really the substantial debate. What is the economic environment capable of producing for the benefit of revenue raising that is going to go to what expenditure? Because if you don't get the revenue in, you can forget all that expenditure. Telling me you can spend $2.8 billion. If you don't collect that revenue, if you don't borrow the monies, ain't nothing gonna happen. So that's what the debate should be about substantially. The caller who called and said, listen, welcome to politics. You're absolutely right. Nobody should expect you go in a political chamber and you're not gonna get some political blows through. Of course you can get it. And the last people should be complaining about political blows thrown should be the Minnis administration. Last people. Because there's no question on planet Earth. I remember in Peter Turnquest's first budget communication, very first budget communication, I said that it had a political tone not typical of budget communications. It did. He did. Right? He threw some blows. Typically, you focus on the numbers, you focus on the message, and it ain't really about the politics. But he did, right? That's how you do it. When me and Ingram were in office, Ingram would read the budget communication, which was fairly much straightforward, not the politics involved. And I would do the seconding of the moving of the budget bills, and then we could throw political blows there. I didn't do a lot of it. But you know, but you expect some to be thrown, right? So they no. The Minnis administration cannot complain about people looking back at what this one did and that one did, because that was a substantial part of their dialogue when they came to office and throughout their term. That's expected. It's going to happen. The Christie administration did it to the Ingram administration. The Ingram administration did it to the Pinden administration. It's going to happen. But it can't be the predominant part of the budget dialogue. That can't, well, it could be, but it shouldn't be. It shouldn't be, is the point that's being raised here. We should get to the numbers. What are the changes? And there ain't no big buggy load of changes. I mean, there ain't no big substantial changes. It isn't like we, nothing earth shattering here, but you do have an obligation to explain to the public what is happening. This text says, Mr. Laing, I believe that $2 million was going in the black hole, and furthermore, if it was the PLP, people would have been saying it's corruption, suck my teeth. Yes, yeah, of course, people could, you know. Says it was wrong for the government to take away the VAT-free bread basket items. They should have left that in place at least for 1 year in conjunction with the decrease in VAT of 10%. Given the economic environment, even though the argument is that persons who did not need it was also benefiting, it should have stayed VAT-free for the poor folks, okay? said he's taking what is being taken from the media, he's taking it from the estimates for the media presented last week. Who's taking what? I might have missed something. Maybe I moved on too quickly. This text says, Laing, the woman said she was volunteering. Then we find out she was getting paid. Well, if she says she was volunteering, well, you know, some people might get such big money paid in their lifetime that if you give them a stipend, they feel like they're still volunteering, you know? Because if they had to negotiate or pay for the work they're doing, they might suggest that you should be paying them 50 and 20 grand. I know, I'm just saying. I'm just saying. All right, I'm going to do something with you all when I come back from the break, because I want to talk about interest rates for a bit, because they feature so heavily now in our the circumstances with borrowing and the like. And so, you know, when we come back, I want to touch on that for the remainder of the show. If you have any questions or comments about the budget and other things, please feel free. We'll talk about those, but I want to touch on this interest rate thing when we come back. Ladies and gentlemen, you're listening to Z Live. I'm Zhivargo, I'm your host. We'll be back after this.
Relationship banking. We take pride in getting to know our clients. You have access to knowledgeable, approachable ambassadors and financial coaches so that we can recommend the best product for you. At Fidelity, we care about you. From your financial health to your physical health, we can relate to you because we're just like you. Come and start your relationship banking experience with us today. Visit us online at fidelitygroup.com. Visit any of our branches in Nassau or Grand Bahama, or phone 356-7764 in Nassau, or 352-6676 for Freeport.
Marsh the car. The lady run into me, Marsh the car.
I hope she had insurance.
If she had insurance, she hop out, pull out her phone, pull out the Royal Star Assurance app, and bang, she was on a video call with an RSA rep, sending pictures of her damage, my damage, filing a claim on the spot.
For real? Our insurance have that kind of app?
You gotta go to RSA for that.
Download the RSA app today, or visit rsabahamas.com to submit your claim online. Live chat available weekdays 9 to 5.
Around the world, Cleveland Clinic is recognized as a leader in healthcare. Our team of experts relentlessly pursues the best for our patients. From groundbreaking cancer research to state-of-the-art heart surgery, life-saving innovations happen here every day. When it's time to travel for your health, it's time to travel to Cleveland Clinic, your destination for care, for every care in the world. To learn more, visit clevelandclinic.org/Caribbean.
This is Guardian Radio, your station for up-to-the-minute news, intelligent, interactive, and engaging conversation. 96.9 FM.
I'm not afraid, to take a stand.
Welcome back. Welcome back, ladies and gentlemen, to Z Live. I'm Zhivargo Laing, your host. So glad you could join us here today on Guardian Radio 96.9 FM on this beautiful Wednesday afternoon. If you want to give us a call today, the numbers to do so are as follows. You can call us on 323-6232. That's 323-6232. Or 325-4316. 325-4316. You can text us on 422-4796. Or you can WhatsApp me on 439-3043. So when you look at when you think about an interest rate, here's the best way to think about an interest rate. An interest rate is the rent that you pay for money you borrow. So you get an apartment from somebody. And the person says to you, okay, I expect you to pay me X amount every month to use this apartment. You don't own the apartment. They are lending you the apartment. And so you pay them a rent. Well, you go to somebody and you say, I want some money from you to borrow some money from you. They say, okay, fine, I'm lending you some money, but you're going to pay me a rent. And the rent is going to be X percent a month, or over an annual basis is going to be X percent. It doesn't matter if they tell you 7%, 9%, 10%, 12%. 12% annually is the same thing as 1% on the loan every month, right? 12 times 1 is 12, okay? So interest rates are rent we pay on money we borrow. That's the rent. The charge for using my money is called an interest rate. That's the rent I charge you. Now, that rate is determined by the risk the borrower assesses it is going to take to lend you that money. Okay? What is a risk? A risk is an uncertainty. If I know exactly what is going to happen in the future, then I don't have any uncertainty about the future. Therefore, I have no risk. I know what is going to happen. So the greater my certainty, the less my risk. Okay? So what happens with what a lender does is the lender says, okay, the money I have, I got from somebody else. Maybe I got it from my equity investors, or I got it from another bank. They charged me 5%. Let's say they charged me 3%. Well, there's not a chance on planet Earth that you are going to get that money that the bank has that it got from somebody else at 3%. There's not a chance you're going to get that money for less than 3%. They're going to start charging you 3%. Then they're going to look at all their other risks and they're going to say, well, you know, the economy in that country isn't going too well. And so maybe the economy has a risk factor of 2 percentage points as to contraction and all that kind of stuff. So I got to account for that. So then they're going to add that risk on top of the 3%. So now you're at 5%. Then they say, well, you know, we could run into some liquidity issues. And so their analysts look at what the liquidity prospects or probability issues are. And they then say, okay, the beta on that is 1%. So now they add that liquidity risk to the money. So now you're at 6%. Then they ask the question, well, what about inflation? Because if I lend you $100 today, that could buy me 100 items at $1. But if later on when you pay me back that money, those items are now $1.25, my money is worth less when you pay it back to me than it would be worth when I lend it to you. So now they assess the inflation risk. So if they think inflation is going to be of the order of 3% or 5% or 2% or whatever, they're now adding the risk factor for inflation in there. So now they're tacking up the money from 6% now to 8% and 9%. That's how interest rates are determined by the lenders. So when I hear us speak about the interest the government of the Bahamas may be paying, or what is happening to its bonds in the marketplace, it can't be detached from the fact that we are now in an inflation environment that is historic by Western standards. So the fact that we have that high inflation means that investors, the people who are buying the government bonds, are going to factor that inflation in what they require to be paid to lend the government that money. They're also going to assess the political, global political risk as a result of the Ukraine crisis. And that's going to factor into the interest rates paid. So all of these things fluctuate in the marketplace as speculators, as buyers and sellers of bonds in the marketplace assess the risk of taking a hold of that bond. So it's not the Bahamas government isn't in charge and in control of the rate it's going to be charged. Only to the extent that it manages its creditworthiness in such a way that it maximizes its creditworthiness is the extent to which it has some control over what might be charged to it in terms of interest. But there is a marketplace of demand and supply for these bonds that's already also going to play a role in how much interest is paid. And it would be like a lack of knowing on our part to think that altogether these rates are determined by ourselves. That's not true at all. The environment, the global environment now is more risky. The inflation environment now is more risky. A number of elements that go into interest rate determinations are more risky, and that's going to mean higher rates for lots of lenders, not just the government of the Bahamas. Now, obviously, if I securitize a loan to you, that reduces the risk because now I have a fallback position, which is the security you give me. Well, if I'm going to give you security, you can't charge me the same interest rate as you would charge me when I had no security. And that's why the repo loan would attract a lower interest rate as a securitized loan than a loan that was not securitized. Because in most instances in the past, the government of the Bahamas' security on loans was its creditworthiness. And that creditworthiness was not merely a function of the size of the debt, but also a function of the economic prospects of the country. So when Kirzner was building Atlantis and the prospect of thousands of more Bahamians being employed, millions of dollars more in revenue being spent, being earned, billions of dollars more in tourist spending because of more tourists coming. When that was happening, the Bahamas' economic prospects were very strong, and that strengthened its creditworthiness because it strengthened the capacity of the government to raise revenue. Well, if you have the reverse happen, when a pandemic shuts you down, reduces your economic activity, well, a creditor now is looking at you and saying, but your prospects for growth ain't that strong no more. And on top of that, you're needing to borrow more money. And so they therefore will factor a couple of things into your scenario of borrowing. One, higher interest rates because you're a riskier lend prospect. And also whether or not I should require some security from you. Now, what we don't know is we don't know if the government offered these securities to, say, for instance, Goldman Sachs or Goldman Sachs required it. It could have been the government said, listen, you know what, I want to go into the marketplace, but I don't want to pay any big interest rates. And so I'm going to offer them some securities in a repo arrangement and do it that way. But the overall idea is that the government isn't altogether in control of the interest circumstances that confront it. The government isn't deciding that the world has a higher inflation rate and so forth, and those things will go into the interest rate calculation. This text says, what is the security, the surety, the collateral on our national debt? None. Right now, the only security on your national debt is the government's creditworthiness. That's it. That was it. There's nothing else. And that comes as a result of the government being able to tax people to get revenue. The only portion of the national debt now securitized is the portion that was just given to Goldman Sachs, which is about $200 million. So of your $11 billion national debt, only $200 million or thereabouts of it is collateralized. All the rest of it is dependent on the government's creditworthiness. How will the balanced budget and pay down the national debt as other countries have? as other, what other countries? First of all, I'm gonna ask you, go and find me another country that has paid down its national debt, please. See how long your list is. So I'm gonna give you some time to do that. You can just Google searches, country start paying down its national debt. Please find it for me. This text says, accountants, financial experts, and economists have us $10 billion in debt, so maybe it's time to listen to some other people. That's nonsense. You're talking nonsense. You know, economists and financial experts have you in $10 billion debt. All your money were borrowed by your governments in office. Politicians borrowed that money. So don't put that. See, again, I keep telling you all, you have to speak in an enlightened and educated way. The way we borrow money in the country is, the Minister of Finance goes to the Parliament of the Bahamas, and most ministers of finance in the Bahamas have been lawyers, not financial experts and not economists, okay? We've had an accountant in recent times. We've had a doctor in recent times. We've had ministers of states who have been economists, but most of your ministers of finance have been lawyers. A.D. Hanna was a lawyer. Pinling acted as that for a time. He was a lawyer. Hubert Ingham was a lawyer. Perry Christie was a lawyer. So you have to speak factually. You're speaking from a basis of non-knowledge. Financial experts have nothing to do with borrowing your borrowed monies. You go to the Parliament of the Bahamas, that's your politicians elected, and they agree to borrow the money. Say, so stop borrowing and trim some of this fat. So the people are unable to pay more tax. The house of cards crumbles. You're absolutely right. That'll happen. So we have countries with no debt. Name me one. Go on, name me the country that has no debt. Stop just putting things out there. I'm going to give you some time since you're texting me directly. All right? Name me the countries that have no debt. Name me a country now. Don't come here with no territory. I'm a country. Say, bought by rogue leaders, they should have to pay it back. This text says, sorry for late text, but I need to hear that the 10% VAT will be removed from bed basket items. There you go. See, you want, as a matter of policy, you want a policy pronouncement that you are removing the 10% VAT on bread basket items. Okay. This text says, this mid-year budget doesn't mean much to me because this will be over in May when a full budget will be presented, will start to be presented. Okie dokie. This text says, great show as usual. According to your analogy, all of us been paying rent almost all our life, and our children will be paying our rent to the bank. Yes, you're absolutely right. Says, great show as usual, Mr. Laing. People were talking about putting the government money in their accounts and paying the money back to the government. Is it illegal, ethically wrong, or did the individual circumvent the system and legally got free? No, none of that. None of that happened. None of that happened, right? It was a mistake. That's what they said. Unless the government comes up with evidence of something untoward otherwise happening, it was a mistake. A mistake. A mistake. A mistake. That's what happened. It wasn't unethical. It was a mistake. There was a misquoting and a misrecording of the funds on the books or whatever. But it was a mistake. That's as far as we know. Until I get better information, that is what I know. Okay, this text says, that's correct, Laing. Lawyers caught us so much in debt. Now, I just don't want you blaming everybody and putting everybody in the same pot. I just want you to know who was your peoples, right? Archimedes was a Greek genius with skill set savvy in areas, namely mathematics, physics, engineering, astrology, and science inventions. He lived from 287 to 212 BC, a leading scientific mind of the day. He was noted for his what is all of that? I thought that was going someplace. Ladies and gentlemen, we're going to take our final break. You're listening to See Live. I'm Zhivargo Laing, your host. We'll be back after this break.
Whatever weather, cold or warm, letting you know that you're not alone. Holler if you feel no debate about is that BTC has the best rates. Now, the best rates just got better because you pay half the price of the other guys with your BTC home internet and mobile services combined. Switching to BTC is a no-brainer because I pay less with BTC and get super fast internet with speeds up to 600 megs. The other guys, their internet only go up to 105 megs.
Get all the internet you want at half the price when you bundle your home internet and mobile. Visit a BTC store to make the switch today. Conditions apply.
If you're looking to diversify your portfolio, chart a course for RF Mutual Funds, where you can get global returns through our suite of internationally invested funds. Get exposure in U.S., Asian, European, and emerging markets without central bank approval. And with financial services leader Morgan Stanley as the advisor of our international funds, you can benefit from RF's global connections. Set sail for international markets today by visiting rfgroup.com. RF, money at work.
Happy anniversary, my gateway. Did you know that you can request and pay for over 35 government services on mygateway.gov.bs? Sign up today and access government services online with efficiency and simplicity. It's a celebration of a year of collective success on our digital transformation journey. My Gateway, making government work for you.
I'm not afraid.
Welcome back, ladies and gentlemen, to Z Live. I'm Zhivargo Laing, your host. So glad you could join us here today on Guardian Radio 96.9 FM for these remaining moments of the show. If you want to call in that time, you can call us on 323-6232 or 325-4316 or 325-4259. You can text us on 422-4796 or you can WhatsApp me on 439-3043. So if you're building a house, the most important structure you put down for that house is called the what? It's called the foundation, right? If you put the most beautiful home on a poor foundation, dog will eat your lunch one day. The foundation matters the most. If you're planning a budget, what's the foundation of the budget? Even if it's your personal budget, somebody tell me, what's the foundation of the budget? What is the foundation of a financial budget? Anybody? Anybody want to venture a guess even? What is the foundation of a financial budget? I have somebody here. Let me tell you something, bro. Let me tell you something. Whoever you are who's texting me, whoever you ask who's texting me, listen, stop. Stop and check yourself, right, about national debt. You don't have a clue what's happening with the debts of countries. You say many countries have low debt. You're talking nonsense. Absolute nonsense. What do you mean low debt? Right? Please, just do some more information, right? Do some more information. You don't have to prove a point. I don't have to prove a point. But do get the right information. That's all I'm saying to you, because you absolutely are not informed in this area at all. Okay, most countries in the world have a huge debt to GDP ratio, most. And the richest countries in the world have the worst, the richest, all right? So stop, all right? Just stop. What's the foundation? So somebody texts me and says, revenue. Okay, right, okay. You say revenue is the foundation of the budget. That actually is a good answer, but it's not the correct answer. But it's a good answer. It really is, because it's closely tied to the real answer. And the real answer is your revenue prospects, right? That's the real answer, is your revenue prospects. So your economic circumstances, that's the real answer. Because if your economic circumstances are bad, your revenue is going to likely be bad. So whether you are going to have a job whether you will maintain the job you have, whether you will increase in your economic earnings, all is a function of your economic circumstances going forward. Because you could be okay today, that's your revenue. But tomorrow you could lose your job and boom, shakalaka, boom, you're done. Okay? So your revenue prospects are the foundation. That's the one on which you actually do your revenue forecast. Your economic prospects is that from which you do your revenue forecast. You believe the economy is going to grow. You believe it's going to grow by this amount. You believe in that kind of a growth economy, you can get this amount of revenue. And that's the basis of your spending. So it's your economic forecast. Let me ask you a question. How much do you know from the budget debate? How much do you know about the revenue, about the economic prospects of the Bahamas going forward? How much do you know? How clear are you on the strategies that are going to seek to produce the economic prospects that will make you better off? How well do you know? I'm not saying that it wasn't said. I'm asking you, how much do you know? How do you know that as well as you know about Ms. Larson and her NGO and how much she's being paid and how much money was transferred to her, to them, and sent back to the government of the Bahamas? Do you know that as well as you know about the economic prospects of the country going forward? Are the unemployed in the Bahamas going to be served by the information we are now debating about the budget more than they are going to be served about the economic prospects of the Bahamas going forward? Is the Bahamas' ability to service its debt going to be enhanced by the information we are now debating coming out of the budget debate versus the economic prospects of the country going forward? The foundation of a budget is economic prospects. Every time the government of the Bahamas has been downgraded, it has been downgraded because its economic outlook has been unfavorable, not strong. So what the people are saying is, well, if you're not in a position to earn and get more money, you're not in a better position to fund your current debt, and therefore your increased debt is going to be an even greater burden, right? So the foundation is, your economic prospects. This person says, not clear, but tourism figures look promising and VAT revenue appearing promising. Yes, yes, the tourism figures going forward look promising in comparison to past, to the pandemic years for sure. So that's one basis for optimism for sure. The VAT revenue, well, that collection is going up largely on the basis of in the economic activity in the country going up. So yes, that's there. What else is out there that tells us that we can have significant optimism in the economic prospects of the country? I'm not suggesting we don't have good economic prospects. What I'm asking you is, based on the fact that it is the foundation for a successful budget, what do you know arising out of the debate about that prospect? So how much of the debate has been dedicated to discussing this foundation, not just on the government side, on the opposition side as well? What have you heard about what our economic prospects are? What have you heard about investments going forward, about domestic or international investments going forward? What have you heard about the tourism strategy going forward? What have you heard about second home or international residency stuff? That's the, and so you might hear more of this as you hear from more and more ministers, but I'm saying to you that this is the kind of stuff that you can walk away from a budget debate and know, okay, good, I got a clear picture. Maybe it could change pretty, you know, but you want it as clear as you could get it, because that gives you the opportunity to plan. That gives you an opportunity to pivot. That gives you an opportunity to know where, you know, maybe I should pull back on this, or maybe I should look differently at how I'm going to do that. That's the point. That's what the budget is supposed to do. It's supposed to give business people, individual economic actors, some insights to better plan their affairs so that if things are going to be leaner, they can make necessary adjustments. If things are going to be better, they can make strategic decisions that could benefit themselves and the economy. That's the idea behind it. So we'll all be watching and listening to see how the debate evolves. But, you know, I know the temptation. I've been in the House of Assembly debating. I know how the thing goes. And I know, you know, that there is a huge impulse to politic. You know, after all, we're politicians. And, you know, you won't put it on them. You won't punch them in the throat. That politics, not physically. I don't want to get like Dr. Minnesota. No, we don't want to punch somebody in the throat. You won't politically knock them out. That's what I mean, politically knock them out. And so you try to find moments when you could say, yeah, you all did this and it was terrible. Or you could find moments where you say, we did this and it was great. It was grand and it really helped, right? That's what you want. That's what you want. I think when you look at some of the participants, they're always in the House of Assembly. Some members who are more on target, more focused than others. Always. There's always in the House of Assembly what I call political muckrakers. Right? They're the ones who go in there. They're going for the guzzle, for your throat. That's really what they're going. They're going in there to do damage politically. They're interested in the numbers. They're not interested in the policies. They're not interested in the legislation. Their job is to politically go inside there and wreak havoc. That's their job. I call them political muckrakers. But there are some people who are policy buffs, and they like to focus on the policy. They like to focus on the actual government activity and what it will mean for the country, and so you will hear them. Then you have some people who they are numbers buffs, so they love to look at the numbers. They love to follow trends. They love to point out when something is increasing and something is decreasing, when something is staying the same. So they'll follow those over years. I'm one of them. I'm a numbers buff. I'm a trend buff. I love to spot trends, look at trends, and so forth and so forth. You know, and then you have people who are a mixture of both. Miss Ingram, to me, as a debater, was a mixture of a details person. He can do the details, he can look at the big picture, but when it's time, he can hit you with a timely hit too, politically speaking. And so he was very savvy that way. Selinden was similar. Selinden was very savvy in terms of being very articulate to present his government's policy and what have you, but when it was time to throw a lick, he could do that without breaking stride and making his thing on point. You know what I mean? Adie Hanna was a policy buff. You know what I mean? Very keen, sharp-minded on the issue. Paul Adley was both a policy and numbers buff. You know, these were all ministers of finance and folk who I am pointing to. You know, James Smith, a numbers buff, and very, very disciplined about dealing with the issues and the policies at hand. Very much so. Michael Alkides, a policy man. Michael Alkides was never somebody who got too much caught up in the political naked fight and what have you. He was always mostly dealing with the issue and trying to make some clarity on whatever was the issue at hand. You know what I mean? I mean, no political muckrakers, because I didn't want to get in that discussion today. But there are some, and there were some clear ones too. All right, this text says we need to improve collection rates, because if 40% collection rate like at NIV, there will be no confidence in us, and borrowing rates will reflect that. It says, good afternoon, Mr. Laing. You said the foundation of a budget is revenue prospects. I said, yeah, economic prospects, yeah. So the foundation is shaky at best without considering spending on expenses, yeah? Yeah. So that foundation is shaky at best without, okay, yeah, you got it. Anyway, ladies and gentlemen, listen, thank you for listening. You've been listening to Z Live. I'm Zhivargo Laing, your host. Y'all have a great day. We'll talk to you again tomorrow. God spares life.
I'm not afraid to take a stand.